Dear friends, I am starting with the dorsal mesocardium, which is a dorsal mesentery of the heart tube, a temporary structure which is formed when the heart tube descends from the roof of the pericardial cavity into the cavity of the pericardial cavity. As it descends, it takes with it a curtain like double layered mesodermal fold of tissue, which is known as dorsal mesocardium. It is a temporary structure and will disappear very soon, but it has two important masses related to it which develop from it. One we have already discussed, that is the proepicardial organ, which is a mass of cells which develops in the cardial part of the pericardium, and it serves as a source of epicardium. It also serves as a source of coronary arteries, tissues for the coronary artery are derived from the proepicardial organ. Similarly, the epicardium is derived from proepicardial organ. But there is another mass of mesodermal cells which form a crust of cells which is called dorsal mesenchymal protrusion. This mass derived from the dorsal mesocardium comes to lie in the roof of the common atrium. Later on, migrates with the septum transversum. We will discuss it again. And when the dorsal mesocardium finally disappears, so anatomically the transverse sinus of pericardium is formed, which lies between the venous and arterial ends of the heart. In the adult, it is represented by the sinus or space between the aorta and pulmonary trunk. This is a diagram showing the mesocardium. Then you can see the mesocardium is disappearing. This whitish shows that it has disintegrated here, and it is disappearing. And these are the transverse sections. This double layered fold of mesenchymal tissue, this is the dorsal mesocardium. It is breaking up, and gradually it finally breaks up and completely disappears. So it is a temporary structure, dorsal mesocardium. But in this caudal part, proepicardial organ will be formed, and another mass of these mesenchymal cells derived from the dorsal mesocardium will form the DMP or dorsal mesenchymal protrusion. Now, the further development of the heart we will discuss under two main headings, that is establishment of the external shape of the heart, external form of the heart, which occurs from 4 to 6 weeks. So by the end of 6 weeks, the heart has taken externally at least its adult shape. And internal specializations is the second topic that we will take, which divide the heart into 4 chambers and 4 valves, etc. These specializations, they start in the 4th week when the external form is being established, but they continue till 8th week, and by the 8th week the heart becomes internally completely specialized, meaning that the right heart and left heart become completely separate from each other, and the arterial and venous bloods, they become separate to a great degree, though in the fetal life there is a mixing between these two bloods that we will discuss. But 4 chambers and the valves and other internal structures are formed by the end of 8th week. Starting with the establishment of external form, so as the heart tube elongates, we have discussed that it shows 4 regions: bulbous cordis, ventricle or primitive ventricle, atrium or primitive atrium, and finally the sinus venosus, which is formed by the confluence of 6 veins. Now, as the heart tube lies within the cavity of the pericardial within the pericardial cavity or cavity of the pericardium, and dorsal mesocardium disappears, the heart elongates, larges in length, and to accommodate the enlargement in length, it compulsorily bends. It has to bend. It is forced to bend, and when it bends, a loop, a U-shaped loop is formed, which is called bulboventricular loop or cardiac loop. So we can diagram later on. When the U-shaped loop is formed, bulbous cord is displaced inferiorly to the right and slightly ventrally, while the ventricle is displaced inferiorly to the left. And in the beginning, the atrium and synaphysis are lying in the septum transversum and are not present in the cavity of the pericardium, but later on they are also pulled out of the sinus of the septum transversum and brought into the cavity of the pericardium, and they come to lie in a dorsocranial position in relation to the ventricle. And the narrow region connecting the atrium and ventricle is externally indicated by a sulcus, which is called atrioventricular sulcus, and internally the atrium and the ventricle, they are connected to each other by a canal, narrow canal, which is called atrium. So this diagram shows us the formation of the bulboventricular loop or cardiac loop. BC is for the bulbous cordis, and ventricle is the primitive ventricle, and you can see elongation of the heart tube results in the creation of this U-shaped loop, which is in the beginning not very prominent but gradually becomes very prominent, and in the lower diagram you can see the U-shaped loop, which is called bulboventricular loop or cardiac loop, because one limb of it is formed by the bulbous cordis and other is formed by the ventricle, and the sulcus between the bulbous cordis and ventricle is called bulboventricular sulcus. So this is a diagram which is quite informative and explains the bulboventricular loop, which is a U-shaped loop, and it is also called cardiac loop. Now we come to the parts of the bulbous cordis and their fate, and then we will pass on to ventricle and other parts of the heart tube. Now bulbous cordis has three parts. As we start from the upper side, go to lower side, go downwards, or we start from the distal side and go to the proximal part of the bulbous cordis. The uppermost tubular, rather narrow part is called truncus arteriosus. Name indicates is the nature. Truncus arteriosus, a trunk, which is arterial trunk, though is divided into little into two channels, which do not form the part of the heart itself, but they form the ascending aorta and pulmonary trunk, which are the great arteries issuing from the heart. They are formed from the part of the bulbous cordis, which is part of the heart tube, but the ascending aorta and pulmonary trunk are not part of the heart. So truncus arteriosus is not forming any part of the heart, but it is forming the great arteries issuing from the heart, their initial parts, that is the ascending aorta and the pulmonary trunk. And the middle part of the conus cordis, middle part of bulbous cordis is called conus cordis, and as we will see later on, it is divided by a septum into two, and it forms the outflow tracts of the right ventricle and left ventricle. Outflow tract of the right ventricle is called infundibulum, and the outflow tract of the left ventricle is formed, is known as aortic vestibule. And the lowermost, that is the proximal part of the bulbous cordis, it becomes rather dilated, and it forms the trabeculated part of the right atrium. So the small part of the right atrium, which is trabeculated is formed by the bulbous girdle, while the non-trabeculated part is formed from the ventricle. The primitive ventricle also contributes to the right ventricle and to the left ventricle as well. So the right ventricle receives contribution from the lowermost part of the bulbous cortex, which forms its trabeculated part, and the primitive ventricle forms its non-trabeculated or smooth part. With this diagram, you can see the parts of the bulbous cortex. Truncus cordis or truncus arteriosus, conus cordis, and when the bulboventricular loop has been formed, then the trabeculated part of right ventricle, this is the lowermost part or proximal most part of the bulbous cortex. Middle part is forming the conus cordis, and the terminal part is forming the truncus arteriosus, which you can see in diagram 3 clearly. And the primitive ventricle is contributing to the right ventricle also, and to mainly forms the left ventricle, but the non-trabeculated part of the right ventricle is formed from the primitive ventricle. Again, I will emphasize that the right ventricle receives contribution from the bulbous cortex as well as from the primitive ventricle. So primitive ventricle is not only forming the left ventricle, though left ventricle, all of it is formed from the or almost all of it is formed from the primitive ventricle, except for the aortic vestibule, which is formed from the conus cordis. But the right ventricle receives contribution from the bulbous cordis, its lowermost part, also from the right part of the conus cordis, which forms infundibulum or conus arteriosus. It also receives contribution from the primitive ventricle. Then this is about the descent of the heart. The heart descends because when heart begins to develop, it lies in the cervical region of the embryo. Later on, when the neck is formed, pharyngeal region develops, pharyngeal arches, pharyngeal pouches are formed, neck appears, the heart descends and descends through a distance of 15 somites and finally comes to lie in the thoracic region. The importance of this fact that it develops in the begins to develop in the cervical region is that when it is developing in the cervical region, it receives its nerve supply from the cervical cardiac branches of the vagus nerve. So the vagus nerve gives branches to the developing heart. Heart then develops and then descends. As it is developing, it descends into the thorax, but it carries its nerve supply with it. That is why the nerve supply of the heart, that is parasympathetic nerve supply or general visceral efferent nerve supply, through the cervical cardiac branches of the vagus nerve remains, and the cervical cardiac branches of the vagus nerve travel through the neck, then through the upper part of the thorax and reach the heart. So that is a proof that the heart descends during development. That is why it is supplied by cervical cardiac branches of the. So now we will talk about the sinus venosus, which is the fourth and last part of the heart tube, which we have already seen in previous diagrams, and we will see again. So it is formed by the confluence of six veins, three major veins from right side and three from the right side. So they as they form a confluence, sinus venosus is formed and it has two horns. Each horn receives three veins from the side of the body, that is right side of the body is draining to the right horn of the sinus venosus, and the left veins from the left side of the body are draining into the left horn of the sinus venosus. But it is important to note here, or to mention here, we will discuss it in the development of veins, that gradually the veins of the left side become smaller and veins of the right side become larger, because some shunts are formed in the venous system which divert the flow of blood, which shunt the flow of blood from the left side to the right side, to the right sided veins. So left sided veins become small and some of them completely disappear, and the right sided veins become large, and because the right sided veins are bringing more blood, they bring it to the right horn of the sinus venosus, which becomes gradually larger and larger in size because it is receiving more and more blood. To accommodate more blood, it enlarges in size. So this enlarged right horn of the sinus venosus will ultimately be absorbed into the right atrium, which we will discuss very soon. The left horn, on the other hand, becomes, excuse me, you can see a diagram here. So this is the sinus venosus, two horns, right horn and left horn, each receiving three veins, the umbilical vein, the vital end vein and the common cardinal vein. But in the next diagram, you will see at about 50 days of development that the left sided veins have almost become dwindled and they are disintegrating, disappearing, and the left horn consequently becomes very small and remains as this coronary sinus. This major part remains as coronary sinus and distal part remains as oblique vein of left atrium. In this diagram it is clearly shown. Yet we can also see that the right sided veins are enlarging in size and changing into superior inferior vena cava and some other veins, and the right horn of the sinus venosus is enlarging in size as compared to the left horn, which is becoming smaller. And finally, this is what remains of the left horn, that is coronary sinus, and this is the oblique vein of the left atrium, and this is the main right horn of the sinus venosus, which will be absorbed into the right atrium and will receive the opening of these changed veins of the right side, which have now changed into superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. And next will show us the that the before we take a diagram, so we are discussing the absorption of the right horn of the sinus venosus into the right atrium. So the right atrium enlarges in size rapidly because of greater blood flow coming to it from the right sided veins, which have become larger, and the flow venous return has been diverted to right side and right sided veins. So the right horn of the sinus venosus becomes larger in size and is gradually absorbed into the right atrium, and as the right atrium enlarges in size, it pulls the right horn of the sinus venosus into its posterior wall. So the posterior wall or posterior part of the sinus venosus is formed from the absorbed right horn of the sinus venosus, and this part is also known as sinus venarum. This is the smooth part of the right atrium. The right venous valve forms the valve of the coronary sinus, valve of the inferior vena cava, and it forms the crista terminalis, which forms a boundary between the smooth part of the right atrium or sinus venarum, which is derived from the right horn of the sinus venosus, and from the wall of the original right atrium, which is thick and is rough and shows irregularities on the inside, which are called musculi pectinati, and the crista terminalis separates the smooth part of the right atrium from the rough part. The smooth part is derived from absorbed right horn of the sinus venosus, while the anterior rough part is representing the original right. So this is a diagram. Here you can see the septum spurium, which is the fused right and left sinus valves. This is the orifice of the sinus venosus, which is guarded by valves, right and left sinus valves, and spirally they fuse to form septum spurium. In this diagram we can see that the sinus venosus is being absorbed into the posterior wall of the right atrium, and we also see that the pulmonary veins are being absorbed into the wall of the left atrium, but that we will discuss later. So this diagram and then this diagram, these are showing the absorption of the sinus venosus in right horn of the sinus venosus into the posterior wall of the right atrium, and absorption of pulmonary into the left atrium, and we will discuss this topic again. And this is a diagram showing the interior of the right atrium. You can see the this anterior part is rough and shows these irregularities, which are called musculi pectinati or pectinate muscles, while the posterior part is smooth and shows no musculi pectinati. Excuse me. So this is the crista terminalis, which forms boundary between the rough and smooth part. It has been, you see, the flap has been turned on the other side to show the interior, otherwise the crista terminalis would be lying somewhere here, but here it has been cut and turned over. The crista terminalis is shown on this side, but it is lying in the anterior wall at the junction of sinus velarum and the rough part of the right atrium. The sinus venatum is derived from the right horn of the sinus venosus, and the rough part is showing musculi pectinati or pectinate muscles, is representing the original right atrium. Now, internal specializations in the heart, we have partly discussed them, but here a summary. The atrioventricular canal is divided into two separate channels. The common atrium is partitioned into right atrium and left atrium by the formation of a septum, which is called interatrial septum. The right atrium is enlarged by the absorption of right horn of the sinus venosus, which we have already discussed. And the left atrium enlarges by the absorption of pulmonary veins into its wall, which we have seen the diagram. We have partly discussed, but we will discuss it again. Then the conotruncal region is divided by a septum, and then interventricular septum is formed, which separates the right and left ventricles from each other. Independent right and left ventricles are formed when interventricular septum is formed, and then cardiac valves are formed, and we will also touch upon the estrogenetic differentiation of the heart wall. So the main purpose, as we have already discussed, of the interspecialization is to make the heart four-chambered and ensure complete separation of the right and left horn, so that in the adult, the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood are completely separate and they do not mix after birth, and the blood flow is unidirectional, only in one direction, and that is ensured by the development of valves. Valves ensure unidirectional flow of the blood and not in the reverse direction, only in one direction, which we know by our knowledge of circulation through the blood, that the blood goes from the right atrium to right ventricle, but not back to the right atrium. From the right ventricle, similarly, the blood goes from the left atrium to the left ventricle, but not back from the left ventricle to the left atrium normally, because valves are present. And similarly, valves are also present at the origins of the pulmonary trunk and aorta, which also ensure that blood goes from the right ventricle into the pulmonary trunk and not back, and from the left ventricle to the into the aorta and not. The division of the atrioventricular canal. The atrioventricular canal is located at the junction of the atrium and ventricle. It becomes quite wide, and there appear two swellings, one anterior in the anterior wall of this canal, one in the posterior wall of this canal. These are called endocardial cushions. So we have an anterior, which is also called ventral endocardial cushion, and a posterior, which is also known as dorsal endocardial cushions. These endocardial cushions finally fuse with each other and form a septum in the atrioventricular canal, dividing into two parts. This is known as septum intermedium or fused endocardial cushion. So here in this diagram you can see this is the atrioventricular canal in which the endocardial cushions have appeared. If it is a posterior view, then we will say that this is the posterior endocardial cushion. Of course, it is a posterior view because you can see the posterior wall of the right atrium, where the right and left sinus valves are guarding the opening of sinus venosus, and this is the septum suburium, and this is the posterior or dorsal endocardial cushion. And so dorsal and ventral endocardial cushions will ultimately fuse, and they are beginning to fuse here, and they finally fuse and form the septum intermedium or fused endocardial cushions. And we take the development of interatrial septum. Interatrial septum is a complex septum, a composite septum. It's formed by the union of two septa, septum 1 and septum 2, and which are also known as septum primum and septum secundum. Septum 1 is known as septum primum, which appears first, and septum secundum is which appears second, and it is the septum 2. And this composite development of interior septum, its purpose is that it allows the passage of blood or shunting of blood from right atrium to the left atrium during intrauterine life, because during intrauterine life the lungs are closed, so pulmonary circulation is not taking place. Blood does not go to the lungs for oxygenation. Oxygenation is occurring in the placenta, so the blood which is returning to the right atrium from the placenta is diverted to the or shunted to the left atrium by a mechanism which is formed due to the formation of septum primum and septum secundum. So we will very soon take how this shunt is formed and how this complex septum is formed. So first, the septum primum or septum 1, so it appears earlier than the septum secundum. It appears in the fourth week from the roof of the common atrium. It is a sickle shaped or crescent shaped septum, and descend downwards towards the septum intermedium of fused intercardial cushion. And at its free edge lies the DMP or dorsal mesenchymal protrusion, which is a mass of cells derived from the dorsal mesocardium, which we have discussed earlier when we discussed the dorsal mesocardium. So, we know that the DMP will, the cells of the DMP will grow into the left atrium, and from the left atrium they will form the pulmonary vein, which grows out from the posterior wall of the left atrium. Some endocardial, some tissue of the endocardial cushions is also derived from dorsal mesenchymal protrusion. So when the Christian septoprimum is growing towards the septum intermedium, there remains a gap between the load free margin of the septum primum and the septum intermedium. This is called foramen primum. This is a temporary foramen, it will be closed later on because septum primum continues to grow towards the septum intermedium and finally fuses with it. And when it fuses with the septum intermedium, foramen primum is closed. But before foramen primum is closed, the upper part of the septum primum shows formation of perforations, holes, and these perforations merge with each other, fuse with each other, and form a foramen in the upper part of the foramen primum, which is called foramen secundum. So by the time the foramen primum is closed, foramen secundum has been formed. So there is no time when the right atrium is completely separate from the left atrium. First, the blood from the right atrium is passing into the left atrium through the foramen primum, but when the foramen primum is being closed, foramen secundum or ostium secundum is formed in the upper part of the septum primum, and blood begins to flow from the right atrium to the left atrium through the foramen secundum or ostium. This diagram shows the formation of septum primum. You can see it is appearing from the roof of the common atrium as a crescent shaped or sickle shaped septum, and it is growing towards the endocardial cushion. This is the dorsal endocardial cushion, this is ventral endocardial cushion. In this diagram you can see they are separate, have not fused with each other, but they will fuse very soon. Here as you can see, septum intermedium has been formed by the fusion of endocardial cushions. These are the fused endocardial cushions. This is a section diagram of a section. This is the dotted line showing the level of section in all these images. We cut a section and then we'll see this is a septum primum appearing from the roof of the common atrium and growing towards the endocardial cushions. And in this diagram we can see that the septum primum has grown quite close to the fused endocardial cushions, and this is the ostium primum, which will be closed as this septum continues to grow in the direction of fused endocardial cushions. But by this time you can see perforations have appeared in the upper part of the septum primum, and these perforations are shown here. The septum primum has become longer and the ostium primum has become narrower or shorter, and ostium secundum is developing in the form of perforations in the upper part of septum primum. This diagram further growth of the septum primum towards the septum intermedium. Ostium primum is very small and is very soon going to close, and ostium secundum has been formed now by the confluence or fusing together or merger of the perforations which were formed in the upper part of the septum primum. These perforations merge with each other and form a single larger foramen, which is the ostium secundum or foramen secundum. In this section, this is the ostium secundum, but the ostium primum is still there. But as we go to next stage, here we see that the foramen primum has been completely closed because the lower free margin of the septum primum has fused with the septum secundum or fused endocardial cushions, and now the communication between right atrium and left atrium is through the ostium secundum. This is the ostium secundum, and the arrow shows that the blood is passing from the right atrium to the left atrium through the ostium secundum, and foramen primum is no more there. Foramen primum is closed because the lower free margin of the septum primum has fused with the septum intermedium or fused endocardial cushions. And in this diagram you can also see that just to the right of the septum primum, another septum has now appeared, which is also crescent shaped or sickle shaped. This is the septum secundum. But this we will discuss in septum secundum, we will discuss in detail later. But this is a very good diagram, and you can very well understand the formation of septum, primum, foramen primum, then disappearance of foramen primum, formation of foramen secundum, and then complete obliteration of foramen primum and enlargement of ostium secundum, and then appearance of septum secundum. So one thing that you have to keep in mind, and you can very well see in this diagram, that both ostium primum and ostium secundum, they are formed in relation to the septum primum. Ostium primum is the foramen between lower margin of the septum primum and septum intermedium, while the ostium secundum is a foramen which is formed in the upper part of the septum primum. So never say that septum secundum is present in the never say that foramen secundum is present in the septum secundum. Septum secundum here forming, there will be a foramen between its load free edge and the fused endocardial cushions, but that is known as foramen ovale and not foramen secundum. So foramen primum and foramen secundum both develop in relation to the septum primum. This is to be remembered, and this is very clearly shown in this diagram. Now we go on to the septum secundum, and we have already discussed that this is the second septum which forms tracheal septum, and obviously it is second, so it appears little bit later than the septum primum. It appears in late fourth week, that appears in early fourth week, and this also appears from the roof of the atrium. This is also crescentic or crescent shaped or sickle shaped, that meaning it has a lower free curved margin, and it grows towards the septum intermedium, and it grows downwards. It covers the septum secundum, which is present in the septum primum. So a valvular mechanism is being formed, and as it continues to grow downward, finally it stops growing, and there remains a large gap which is oval in shape, large gap between its lower free margin and the septum secundum or fused endocardial cushions. This large oval gap is accordingly called foramen ovale. So it is usually termed, it is pronounced as foramen ovale, but the correct pronunciation is foramen ovale. And when this happens, the upper most part of the septum primum, which is lying superior to or upper to the foramen secundum, and disappears, and remaining septum primum, that is lower part of the septum primum, is now known as valve of the foramen ovale, because it is covering the foramen ovale, and this forms a valvular mechanism which allows flow of the blood from the right atrium to the left atrium, unidirectional flow of blood, because the right atrium is receiving oxygenated blood through the inferior vena cava from the placenta, and this blood has to be passed to the left atrium so that it goes to left ventricle. This diagram shows us the formation of septum secundum. This is also crescentic, sickle shaped in appearance. It also appears on the roof of the atrium, just to the right of the septum primum. This is septum primum, and this is the gap, the upper part of the septum primum, which is the ostium secundum or foramen secundum. And you can see that as the septum secundum is growing downwards, it is gradually covering the ostium secundum, and a valvular mechanism is coming into existence. In this section, you can see this is the ostium secundum in the foramen, in the septum primum, and foramen primum has been closed. and ostium secundum or foramen secundum is there in the upper part of septum primum, and this septum secundum is growing downwards and it is now gradually covering the foramen secundum. In this diagram, it has grown further downwards and most of the ostium secundum has been covered. You cannot see it from the right atrium side. You can see in this section the foramen secundum is being covered by septum secundum. It is going downwards and there is a gap between the lower free margin of the septum secundum and the septum intermedium. This gap finally remains because lower free margin of the septum secundum does not go and fuse with the septum intermedium, and this oval gap, large oval gap in the septum secundum is known as foramen ovale, and foramen ovale is covered by this lower part of the septum primum, which is now called valve of the foramen ovale, and this upper part of the foramen of the septum primum is gradually disappearing, degenerating, and finally, as you can see in this diagram, this upper part of the septum primum is completely gone, it is completely degenerated, disappeared, and lower one is there. It is acting as a valve of the foramen ovale, which allows the passage of blood from the left atrium to right atrium, but blocks the passage of blood from right atrium to left atrium. So it is a valvular mechanism which persists throughout the fetal life. This is a diagram showing the foramen ovale, and this upper margin of the foramen ovale, which is formed at the lower free margin of the septum secundum, is present even in the adult, as we will see. The diagram of the adult we will take at the end. This is again diagrammatic representation of the two septa. This is the septum primum. Blue is the septum primum. Once again, this is a repetition or recapitulation of what we have already discussed. Septum primum, here we can see it has fused completely with the septum intermedium, and no septum and no foramen primum is there. In this region, there was a foramen, which was foramen primum. It is no more there, and it is completely closed. And you can see these foramina in the upper part of the septum primum. These foramina are fusing with each other to form the ostium secundum or foramen secundum, and this greenish yellow is the septum secundum, which has appeared just to the right side of the septum primum. This is also a crescent shaped septum, and this grows downward. Its free margin gradually grows towards the septum intermedium or fused endocardial cushions. Diagram, you see that the septum secundum, this greenish yellow septum, has grown downward towards the endocardial cushion, partly fused with it, but there remains a gap in it, which is an oval gap, which is called foramen ovale, and through this foramen ovale, blood passes from the right atrium, and through between the foramen, between the septum secundum and septum primum, and then passes through the foramen secundum, and it comes to the right atrium. So this is a valvular mechanism. This is for septum primum, showing the septum septum primum, and this is the septum secundum. The septum primum shows the foramen secundum, and the septum secundum has foramen primum. So this is sometimes students are confused. Again, I will re-emphasize it that the septum primum has in the beginning foramen primum, which disappears, then it has foramen, second hemiostium, second. So both foramen, primum and foramen, second are formed in relation to or in the foramen, in the septum, primum. So ostium secundum is also present in the septum primum, not in the septum secundum. The foramen in the septum secundum is foramen ovale. This is to be remembered. So after birth, the two septa fuse with each other. Why? Because now the lungs open and the blood passes into the lungs and returns to the right atrium. And from the right atrium, it is not passing to the left atrium at all. Now the blood from the right ventricle passes to the pulmonary trunk to the lungs, and from the lungs it returns to the pulmonary veins to the left atrium, and the pressure in the left atrium rises, and this pressure rising, pressure of blood in the left atrium pushes the flexible septum primum, which is just remaining as the valve of the foramen ovale. It pushes it and forces it to fuse with the septum secundum, which is rigid, which is thicker and rigid, and the two septa fuse with each other, and definitive interatrial septum is formed by fusion of septum primum and septum secundum. But in 20 to 25% of the people, the fusion is not actual and physical, but just they remain in contact with each other firmly, and this condition is called propatent foramen ovale or propatency of foramen ovale. And this does not cause any clinical symptoms because this does not allow the passage of blood from the right atrium to the left atrium or from the left atrium to the right atrium. And propatency of foramen ovale is to be considered a normal condition because it is there in 20 to 25% of the normal population. And the foramen ovale can be recognized in the adult as fossa ovalis, which is present in the right atrium, and the upper free margin of the fossa ovalis represents the lower free margin of the septum secundum. Septum secundum when stops short, its lower free margin forms the upper margin of the fossa ovalis. Fossa ovalis is itself representing the foramen ovale of the embryonic and fetal life. And this raised margin, superior raised margin of the fossa ovalis is called limbus fossae ovalis or annulus ovalis. And as I've told you, the annulus ovalis represents the lower free margin of the embryonic septum secundum. So this diagram shows the fusion of the two septa after birth. This is the septum primum. Of course, its upper part normally disappears. It is flexible, but the septum secundum is rigid. When the pressure rises in the left atrium, it forces the septum primum to fuse with the septum secundum. And then adult septum is formed, and this is the foramen ovale, and this is the foramen secundum. But the foramen secundum then cannot be recognized in the adult left atrium, but the foramen ovale remains as fossa ovalis in the adult. As we can see in this diagram, this is the foramen, remnant of the foramen ovale, which is the fossa ovalis, and this is the upper margin, raised margin of the fossa ovalis. This is called limbus fossae ovalis, and this is representing the lower free margin of the septum secundum, because this fossa ovalis is actually the representative of foramen ovale, which is the gap between lower free margin of the septum secundum and the septum inter medium. And this is the crista terminalis, which is separating the sinus venarum or smooth part of the right atrium from the anterior trabeculated rough part of the septum of the right atrium, and this opening of the caudal sinus, opening of the inferior vena cava, opening of the superior vena cava, and here we finish with the discussion of the development of the interatrial